see.
Bobby said that some were complaining about it being too cold. I told him to leave it alone because I'm preaching on hell this morning. That's no joke. I don't know where it was, but I was somewhere pastoring years ago, and we used to constantly have complaints from people. You know, the it's too cold, it's too hot. You know, the humidity's too high, the humidity's too low. And so somebody came up with an ingenious idea. We installed a new thermostat. This is the truth. We kept the one that really controlled everything in a hidden place. We left the one there, but we disconnected it. And we let anybody that wanted to go tamper with it. And invariably, when they moved that thermostat, they'd sit down and 5 minutes later, they felt better. Now you explained that to me, and that's the truth. I told Bobby that one time. That they always felt better when they felt like everybody wants to feel like they control something, you know. So it made them feel good that they controlled the heat of the air. So we didn't have any more complaints. You know, I'm glad I left before they found out the truth, because the preacher always gets the blame. He's got the blame for all of that. Got a little note here this morning from Harold C. Johnson Elementary School to Union Baptist Church. Thank you so much for the donation of book bags and school supplies. We're all appreciative of your thoughtfulness and support. Thank you for thinking of HCJ students. And we're so glad we could do that. Amen?
Amen.
We're glad to have some people here this morning. Jerry, we're glad you're back.
I'm glad to be back.
Any of you notice anything different about Jerry?
No ponytail.
We're glad to have Jerry minus ponytail or with ponytail. It wouldn't matter. He's had a tough time, and we're glad he's able to return. Miss Debbie's had surgery, and she's back. And Miss Corrine, we're always glad to see Miss Corrine. She has a rough time with her back problems and went to a new doctor this week, and she's about the same. But we're glad you're here this morning. Always glad to see you. All right, let's do our call to worship this morning. Let's stand and... No, we're going to sing first. I'm about to get ahead of myself. I've got a lot on my mind and I'm in a little bit of a hurry this morning, so Greg's going to come lead us, then we'll have prayer to go off in response to it.
Yes, let's stand together and sing our opening song, Change My Heart, O God.
Change my heart, oh God. May I
responsive reading is taken from the 145th Psalm, and so I will extol you, my God, O my King. I will bless your name forever and forever and forever.
Every day I will bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord, greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable.
One generation shall praise your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts.
I will meditate on the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works.
Men shall speak of the might of your awesome acts, and I will declare your greatness.
They shall utter the memory of your great goodness, and shall sing of your righteousness.
The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and great in mercy.
The Lord is God to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works.
All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your saints shall bless you.
They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power.
The man humbles himself in the end, his mighty acts, and the glorious majesty.
Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and holy in all his works. Amen and amen. Come join us for prayer at the altar. I have an additional prayer request. Gene Copeland asked me to mention his daughter's father-in-law, Fred Mayhew, who had a serious heart attack last evening. And Gaston. Jerry, come up here and let me hold your hand, friend. And thank God for your being here this morning. Father, our hearts rejoice today because Jerry laid in that hospital bed for a number of days and been at home for quite a time. And we just rejoice this morning in your goodness and your mercy to he and Pat and the family. The fact that he's able to be here in our presence this morning to worship you. We give you eternal thanks for that. We thank you that Miss Debbie is able to return after her surgery. We thank you that Miss Corrine is here this morning, having been out a few weeks. We pray this morning for Miss Rebecca, who's not able to be here. We pray for this one that Jean has asked us to remember. He lies in a hospital bed in Gastonia this morning. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you might bless him and his family. Be gracious to them, Lord. For all of those on our prayer list this morning, we just ask that you bless them. Lord, we thank you for our country. There's much about it today that troubles our hearts. And we pray for those who are going through the most difficult of times that you'd bless them. I pray for those of our church family, Lord, who seem to have wandered away. I pray that the Holy Spirit of God would move upon their hearts even this morning. I pray you'd bless worship. I pray you'd bless the sermon this morning to the salvation of some lost soul. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, buddy.
Okay, let's continue with another song this morning as we move right along. Our next hymn is In His Time, so let's stand together and sing In His Time. 681 if you're using a hymnal.
Every day.
another song before our offering time, and this one is an old familiar hymn, He Leadeth Me, 609, and we'll do all three verses and then have a time to present our offerings and tithes to God. So let's sing together.
Truly worship you in spirit and truth, dear Lord, and that you would help us radiate your truth to every person we come in contact with, dear Lord, that we might be a better witness for thee in everything that we do and say. Dear Lord, we pray that you would open our hearts to the message that be brought this morning, dear Lord, that we would listen, that we would apply it to our lives, and that we would go out of here better people than we came. Thank you, dear Lord, for all the things you do for us. Help us, dear Lord, to love you enough that we would study your word, dear Lord, and apply it to our lives. Dear Lord, we pray now that you would take these tithes and offerings and that you would bless them to the furtherance of thy kingdom here on this earth. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Satan is a master. He's the prince of the power of the air. And two of the things that he is so focused on is distracting us in a moment like this, taking our attention away from God, and directing our attention to ourselves, our attention to what we'll do later on this day. Father, he's also mastered blinding us. Not only does he blind the unbeliever, he's especially a master at blinding the believers in Christ. Blinding us to truth, to what really matters, what's most important in life. He does that in my life. So forgive me for allowing my own self to be distracted and to turn away sometimes. And I pray the power of the Holy Spirit upon us this morning because, Father, these without question are some of the most crucial, critical days that we've lived in our whole lifetime. There's a lot at stake. There's a lot in the balance. Some stand at a crossroads this morning, not only here, but, Father, in other places where the gospel is being heralded this morning. Thank you for those that in these days, these difficult days, are hearing the gospel and coming to know Christ as their own personal Lord and Savior, making decisions, as Stephanie was just sharing with me, crusading California. We thank you for that. And we pray that someone may come alongside these and disciple them in Christ. And Father God, I especially pray this morning for this very heavy heart that I have. And you'd use me as your instrument in your hands to herald your truth this morning in Jesus' precious, precious name I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, I hope you'll listen this morning. There's so much on my heart that I find it very difficult sometimes to know where to start and where to end. One of the things that I'm extremely confident of, and that is that Satan is a master of blindness. And there's no doubt in my mind that there are many Christians who are being blinded by Satan today. I appreciate you being here, and I want to believe in my heart that you want to hear the truth. You want to live the truth. You want to know where we're going. Jesus said on one occasion, you know, I don't know when the Father's going to send me back. That's all in his power. But he went on to say, there are signs. And if you're wise, and I'm paraphrasing this, if you're wise, you'll discern the signs of the times. And the Bible has given us over and over and over signs that relate to his coming back again. And if you don't see them today, then you have been blinded big time by Satan. If you really want to know truth and understand truth, I'm going to give you some scriptures to begin with this morning. You write them on the back of your bulletin, write them somewhere, but go home and spend some time looking at them today. There are some passages that I think if you read under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God, there is absolutely no question in my mind if you do it, under the leadership and guidance of the Holy Spirit. The natural man cannot understand the things of God, but the Holy Spirit of God gives us understanding. Right? And these aren't difficult passages to understand. Matthew chapter 16, read it. Matthew 24, read it. Luke 21, read it. 2 Timothy 3 and 4, read it. They will tell you something of what's going on in the world today, this morning. It seems that we never come to Sunday anymore. And when we look back on the week that has preceded us, that there are not some acts of violence that have happened that startled us. One of the things that the Bible tells in these passages that I have given you this morning is that one of the sure signs of the last days is violence. Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 3, this word just stood out, jumped off the page at me. It said in that 2 Timothy 3 and 4 passages are really crucial. But Paul said in that passage that one of the signs of the latter days that precede my coming, Jesus said men will be brutal. B-R-U-T-E-L. Brutal. Brutal. You'd have to be blind and deaf and dumb not to understand how relevant that one word is to this past week. Never in our lifetime have we seen, watched on live television, three people gunned down. Never. On live television. Brutal. The one lady, God had to have a reason to leave her here. Not only did he shoot her, he stood up over her once he shot her and continued to try to shoot her, and he ran out of bullets. And that's a miracle from God that she's alive. That's brutal. And I'm going to say something. Some of you may not like it, but I think you know me well enough to know I really don't care. You ain't heard one word out of Washington about hate crime. Show it to me, because I haven't heard it and I haven't seen it. If that's not a hate crime, I don't know what a hate crime is. Folks need to wake up. Take action. I'll stop at that. And then, of all things, sure, I'll talk to you about this earlier. I mean, this made me so angry. You don't want to hear some of the words that I've used this week. When that sworn law officer was gunned down, shot him in the back of his head, and while he's laying there, he stands over it and continues. But if that's not brutal, then I don't know what the word brutal means. I mean, that in itself. Those two acts in themselves ought to tell us we live in a brutal age. And Jesus said, before I come back, I don't know when it's going to be. But he said, time's going to be brutal. One other thing that really caught my attention, and I'm not preaching on quote the second coming this morning. This is free. I won't charge you for overtime. This is free. You know what Jesus said? Jesus said that the days that precede my coming will be like the days that preceded Noah entering the ark. And if you go read Genesis, this is what you'll find. It says that the days of Noah were days of violence.
How can we miss that, folks? I told Rick coming to work this morning, the Bible says something else. Men's hearts shall fail them for fear of those things coming upon them. Don't you know that every morning? Don't you know that every morning when a police officer gets up and dresses and puts his uniform on and starts out the door, listen to me, Kevin, don't you know that his wife and his parents and his children live in something of fear? Don't you know that? I mean, they've got to. That happened in Houston, Texas. There have been 3 officers slain in the state of Louisiana in the last couple of weeks. The officer down in Birmingham, Alabama, was brutally beaten. And you know what all the commentators are saying? The reason he didn't respond, you know what they're saying? He's afraid of what if he had responded. You know what he used to tell my son when he was on highway patrol? I said, son, I'd rather borrow money and hire you a lawyer than to find 6 people to kill your life. This man back here will tell you there is a split second. And friend, when I tell you there's a split second, between that man's life and a criminal's life. And you don't have time to debate with it. Now, is that gun really got live bullets in it? That's what they think sometimes. They think, well, he ought to enter into conversation with that guy. Find out what his intentions are. You do that, you're dead. It's a violent age. And we, folks, we need to wake up. We need to demand something by politicians. If preachers all across this land would stand up today and encourage their congregation, let's take a stand on the side of what's right. Not what's politically right, what is biblically, morally right to do.
Amen.
But it's coming to an end. There's a, you hear people say this sometimes. Somebody's got their back against the wall. You may have been there sometime and seemed like the pressures of everything were just crowding in upon you. And have you ever said, where do I go from here? You ever find yourself saying that? Well, I'm going to twist that around a little bit this morning. When you come to the end of the way, where do you go from here? You're going somewhere. When you leave this world, have a guy that I was witnessing to one time back in jail and trying to share the gospel with him, trying to encourage him to change his way of living. And I said, you know, you're going to die. It's slow death. You know, cirrhosis of the liver, blah, blah, blah. I said, and when you die, what? I said, what? He said, they're going to bury me. You know what? Before they ever put you in the ground, you'll either be in heaven or you'll be in hell. You hear me? You see, there's an eternity out here. There was a day. I better get around these notes. If I don't, Eddie, you may have to. Eddie smoked me up something. I don't know what. Said he smoked me something. I wanted to know if there's something I could use to make smoke stimulate or something like that. Smoke or something. I'm a little bit afraid Eddie's smoking me anything. I don't know what's in it. So we may have to go downstairs and get that smoke thing out of the refrigerator and share it with everybody before I get through here today. And somebody did bring me a bag of apples, so we could share the apples and whatever the thing is, and we wouldn't have to lease or. Now listen to me, Kevin. there'll never be a time when you won't be. Did you hear me? There was a time when you did not exist, but there will never be another time that you do not exist. So.
Wow.
Never be a time. God made every human being, you know what for? Eternity. The Bible is very clear that at the end of this life, you will spend eternity in one of two places. Either in heaven with God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit, or you spend eternity in hell with Satan. Now people don't believe that. The latest surveys that are taken indicate that a high percentage of people, that's what old men like me believe. That's some concoction of some man who was in a mental institution somewhere and he wrote about it. I mean, people believe crazy stuff like that. But it's not a reality. Hell is as much a reality as this heaven. Jesus spoke about both heaven and hell. In the 14th chapter of John, Jesus said to his disciples who were very distraught and disturbed, Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. When I saw what I told you, go to prepare a place for you. If I'm going to prepare a place for you, I've come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, that ye may be also." And Thomas said unto him, "Lord, we know not where to go. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said emphatically, "I, Jesus, am the way, the truth, the life. No man cometh unto the Father except by me."
Amen.
Friend, if you didn't have anything else, if there was not another word in the Bible about heaven, that's all you need.
Amen.
That's all you need. And then the same Jesus that spoke about heaven spoke about hell. But he said there was a rich man, fared sumptuously every day. He wore the best of clothing. He ate the best food. They brought a beggar full of sores, laid him at the gate. He hoped to catch some of the plums that fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, it says the dogs came and licked him. And he died. I want you to listen to this. I could spend the rest of my time right here. Because I believe something that a lot of people don't really believe. But Jesus said it. I believe it. Jesus says the angels came and carried him. All of my heart, listen to me very carefully. I believe that whenever a child of God dies on this earth, I believe the angels come and carry them to heaven.
Amen.
I've seen it more than one time in my years in the ministry. I've seen people who lay on a sick bed for weeks at a time, unconscious for days on end, and toward the end, listen, some of you have seen this. Toward the very end, they'll open their eyes and they'll look up. Some of them even raise their fingers. You know what they're seeing? They're seeing that the angels from heaven come to take them to the Father's house. Some of you have seen it. Why should we doubt Jesus? It's just like he said in John 14, if there were some other way, I would have told you so. Jesus is saying emphatically, "I'm telling you the truth." Don't you think he told the same truth when he told the story of the rich man and Lazarus? And the rich man died. And in hell, the same Jesus who said, "Heaven said hell." And in hell, he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off. He said unto him, "Father Abraham, would you not send Lazarus, or not send that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in these flames?" If they would not believe Moses and the prophets,
They would not believe though someone came back from the dead. And I believe that. I believe if a man who had been buried and rose and stood in this pulpit, I believe there'd be multitudes of people who wouldn't believe it. There's heaven. Thank God for it. We'll talk about it in a moment. And there's hell. Both are places. Jesus specified specifically there is a place called hell. And there's an agonizing, woeful place of suffering and torment and fire and pain. What kind of place is heaven? Well, you had it in your Sunday school lessons this morning, and when I began to prepare this message on Monday, I had not read this morning's Sunday school lesson. Read Revelation 21 along with those other passages. I mean, it's an awesome place. I mean, what must the Garden of Eden have been like? I'm not a golfer. I have golfed in the past. I quit golfing because everybody I played, I beat. I just got tired of embarrassing these fellas. I keep promising Jerry back here that I'm going. They tell me he's a great golfer. I think I'm going to take my clubs out of storage, go out there and whip up on you one day. Jerry, you're going to meet you. I'm going to catch him while he's still sick. He ain't got a chance. But I don't have a golf at all. I used to golf some seriously, but every time I faced a pond of water, I got psyched out, and I was getting those kids that were getting those wet balls out of the ponds. I was making a bridge, so I just quit. I could not hit over a body of water, and I know it's all up here, but I couldn't do it. But they tell me that even if you don't care about golfing, that if there's any way possible, go down to Augusta and see that golf course. I've had people tell me that it has to be a little bit of heaven. It's this most beautiful, awesome place. Any of you ever been, any of you? Well, some of you have. Never been there. But every time I think about the description that folks give me of the Augusta golf course, I think that must be just a tiny bit of what heaven is like. Beautiful. There's some things that you won't find in heaven. You won't find sin there. You won't find sickness. You won't find sorrow. You won't find pain. I tell my undertaker friends, you know, you're going to be out of a job in heaven if you get there. But we know undertakers in heaven. All the things that create so much sorrow and pain and suffering and agony for us in this life, listen, folks, it won't be in heaven. Read Revelation 21, miss a Corrine and I were talking before the service. She's been in so much pain. I said, you know, there's coming a day, Miss Corrine, and it ain't too far off when there won't be any more pain. Amen. Thank God. No more pain when we get to heaven. It's going to be a brand new heaven. You know that? Let me ask. I found something this week. In fact, I was telling this deal about this. I know he's an animal lover, and he's got that horse on the other he loves so much. How old is that horse? How's your horse? Old as you?
They say a horse, every year he lives, it's 3 years to a man. So I got a horse 30 years old in my age.
He's your age.
said something that I just had to take the back seat. People have asked me all of my life in the ministry, preaching, do you think there'll be any animals in heaven? We don't have any love. That's why you shaking your head. Well, I have always said to people, I'm sorry. I've always said to people, I don't believe any animals in heaven. I've said that, and I'm being dishonest with you this morning. Well, this guy, who's very he's just straight. He's just a good guy. The teacher of the father. And I got to go back and study, but he said there will be animals in heaven. There are horses in heaven, is that?
Yeah.
There are horses in heaven. Mm-hmm. So my little buddy's going to be with me in heaven. Amen. I mean, whatever is going to make life delightful. Whether it's a horse or a puppy dog or whatever it is, God's going to have it for us. And boy, I don't know what you have. Some of you especially ought to just be thrilled this morning to know that those things that you cherish, that everybody like this crazy preacher said won't be there, there are some. And the more when I looked at that and I thought about it, there were animals in the original garden in the spring. But whether animals or not, you know what? God's going to be there. And we're going to see him face to face. And Jesus is going to be there. And we're going to see him face to face.
Amen.
I mean, just, I see a few smiles. There's hell. There's hell. The hell's a terrible place. I believe it's just the way Jesus said it was. I believe it's exactly the way Jesus said it was. I believe it's a place of pain. I believe it's a place of suffering. I believe it's a place of sorrow. I believe it's a place that none of us want to go, or we don't want our loved ones to go. And if what I believe, listen to me in closing, if what I believe is right, and I believe I'm right, based on this book, folks, I'll tell you something. We're not far from that time. But everybody's going to be in one of two places. If you have a look, listen to the closing. This is extremely important. There's not but one way to heaven, Jesus. And the Bible says, listen to it. Listen to the carriage. The Bible says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father. It's not just saying something. It's doing something. And we're going to give God an account for our lives. In every church today, one of the things, too, the Bible says will happen toward the end time, there'll be a great falling away. Friend, if you question that, you ask any preacher. If there's a lack of commitment on the part of his church members, and you know what they'll tell you? Yes. Gene was telling me this morning, he saw in the news, church over in Union,
Monroe.
In Union County, Monroe area, in the Monroe area, that's closing its doors. There's a church in Rock Hill that's nigh unto the bank taking back the property because they can't pay the bills. Church in Rock Hill at one time ran 500 people in church, 500 on a Sunday. Last week they had to fire, not fire, they let their secretary go, because they could not pay their salary. And it's got some extremely wealthy people in that congregation. And everywhere you turn, there are people, listen to the carefully, I've watched this for years. If I didn't believe so strongly in the Word of God and what the Word of God teaches, it'd be easy for me to get real depressed because there are people like you this morning and when I came here as pastor or since then came and were faithful. And I had a conversation with one of them this week and I warned him. I said, if you don't turn your life back around, you're going to end up worse than you were before you said you came to Jesus. He still ain't here. I'm telling you, folks, there's a great falling away among the people of God. And the people of God who are for real like you need to get concerned about them and do something
human church. You need to look around and see those who aren't here, and you need to begin to get concerned about their spiritual condition. Some of them are as lost as a goose. Because John said if they had been of us, you just studied this in Sunday school, John said if they had been of us, they would not have walked away from us. Right? John said if they had been for real, they may have made a decision in some meeting somewhere. They may have quoted some prayer. But if they had genuinely been born again of the Spirit of God, indwelled by the Holy Spirit of God, you don't walk away from that. And the Bible says the way to hell is broad, and many there be which go in thereat, and the way to heaven is narrow, and few there be that find it. You need to get concerned about your loved ones. And you and I are going to give an account to God.
Let me close with this. I love this book.
You couldn't tear me away from this book. I tell you, I'd fight you over this book. See how many times I've got it. I've got all kind of notes in here. I've got all kind of things. You know, I mean, yesterday. So let me give you another man's thoughts. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and I will commend that to your reading. Also this week, 2 Corinthians 5 helps you to understand a little more about heaven. Paul, the apostle, said, for we must all appear before the... He said it's the tribunal, the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may be rewarded for what he has done in the body, whether it's good or worthless. And then Dr. Blackwood said there are many motivations in the Christian's life. One is our awareness that one day, every single one of us are going to stand face to face with God, and we'll give an account of our lives. Sits in judgment upon humanity. It's much more comforting to believe that Christians will be ushered into heaven with no questions asked about our faithfulness upon earth. But that is not what Scripture says will happen. Paul cautioned that in the final day of judgment, every Christian will give an account of his or her actions to God. This expectation terrified Paul and motivated him to strive to please God in everything he did. 2 Corinthians, that passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, read it. Paul knew that although he might ignore the Spirit's quiet voice during his life on earth, a time of accounting would come when he would have to explain why he had rejected God's instructions. Paul never carelessly assumed that because of all he had done for God's kingdom, God would overlook his sin. Instead, he understood that to whom much is given, much is required. And we've been given much more in America than any other people on the face of God's earth. You hear me? God has not been as merciful and gracious and blessing upon anybody else in the world as he has with Americans. We have it. What don't we have? You think about it. God does not force his will upon us. He'll ask us to answer for the way we responded to him. Christians have been pardoned by the sacrifice of Jesus. We are not condemned, but because God is absolutely just, we'll be called on to give an account of our actions. The Christian life is a tremendous freedom, but it also brings a passive sense of our accountability to God and others. We can learn from Paul that accountability is healthy. It gives us a powerful motivation to please God. There are two things that motivated Paul: faithfulness for God. Listen to this carefully. Number one is love. Because of all that God has done for him. I mean, how in this world, listen to this, how in the world can you not give God the best you've got in light of what he did for you? No one else could have done that for him. No one else could have done that. Second motivation was accountability. Well, now, let's get real practical about this thing this morning, preacher. You really don't believe God can keep up with all the billions of people in the world. You don't think that's possible, do you? That ain't nothing to God. Last evening, Mary got on. I, I, I'm, looking up some stuff for me on the internet. And somehow something happened and all this stuff began to appear. You got a virus coming. I said, call the doctor real quick, let's get some a virus on the way. Well, she picks up the phone, she calls. I'm actually sitting in the other room, but I could hear because she had her on speakerphone, so she could hear the person better. I heard her talking. Well, I knew this person ain't one of us. They ain't one of us. She talked a while, but finally I got up from where I was, and I went in there, and I said, ask them where they are. I don't know where you are. That's why she said, where are you? I'm in India. And all the way from India, she's tapping into our computer some 5,000-6,000 miles away. She's tapping into our computer. And she's changing stuff on our computer. Maybe tell me right quick now. We don't do banking on the computer. I want to rip a banking together. But my point is, if man has the capability of doing those things, why does it amaze us that the God of the universe who created everything, that he would have a difficult time keeping up with little old me or you? So don't think you're going to stand before God one day and give him some flimsy excuse. You know what an excuse is? Somebody defined it this way. An excuse is a big lie covered with the thin skin of truth. And then most Christians have 57 varieties of excuses, just like Campbell's soup. Every excuse under the sun. I'm working right now. I'm working. I've got some people who are smarter than I am. I'm interacting with them in their lab. And they're working on an aspirin that'll work on Monday as well as it does on Sunday. And if they can get that created, we're going to get rich. It's amazing the excuses people give on Sunday that aren't valid on Monday. Right. I'll tell you something, you love Jesus. You know, unless you're sick, unless you're somebody like Ms. Corrine here, that I just want to watch you. I'm just talking about that. No, it's an effort. It's an effort for those folks to come. I'm not talking about that, but I'm talking about help. Do anything under the sun, anything they want to do. And friend, you tell me that person loves Jesus. And I've got an hour in Arizona, I'm going to sell you. But friend, you never convince me this side of glory that somebody loves Jesus. It's going to let some flimsy excuse people serve God. And the truth is, one day, this all. This all will pop in square in your eye. And God's going to say, take me. And that's why Blackman says the saddest thing in judgment is going to be when God shows you. Man, aren't you glad you're going to heaven? Are you sure you're going to heaven? Man, he could come back to that. I mean, you read those passages that relate to a second coming, and you come back to the next Sunday, you tell me, preacher, I didn't find anything that was relevant to where we are. No. I said, what you been reading? You've been reading the Reader's Digest or something. You haven't been reading the Word of God. Every week is something new. It's almost, I told Mary this morning, I thought, I said, there's coming a time that some of you think this is crazy. There's coming a time when we will not be able to drive safe from where we live right now to Filbert, South Carolina. So, it's coming.
Yeah.
It's coming. It's coming, folks. Let's get right with God for ourselves. I mean, I've got children. I'm going to tell you something. They died today. They're going to bust hell wide open. It tears my heart out. Daddy, I know. Bobby and I talked about that this morning. You talked to When he left his wife, his two children, he had no idea. But he walked out of that door, he could never see those children, that wife or something. And you don't know what could happen to you.
Amen.
Get ready to meet God. Get ready to meet God. I thank you that you've given all man enough energy to share the truth of the Word of God. I thank you for people who listen. I thank you for the Holy Spirit who's working even now to draw people to know Jesus as the Lord and Savior. Lord, I'm not talking about joining the church. I'm not talking about saying a prayer. I'm talking this morning about all of us just simply saying, Lord Jesus, here I am. I'm going to get off the throne of my life and put you as my King, my King, my King, my King, my Lord. In Jesus' name. Grace will come lead us. If you know you're saved, thank God for it. Maybe you need to come and pray for your unsaved children. If you're not saved, I wouldn't put off giving my life to Christ. Come, let's talk about it this morning. Give you a chance to surrender your life to Christ. Stand with us as we sing. Just stand here too. Appropriate hymn, have our way to work. Are you faithful to it? Could you honestly take it this morning? Deal with a lot of different kinds of people. Some father mentally deranged. lives in danger, Father, every day that they might protect us. And I'm going to pray for them this morning. I thank you, Father. And I pray you protect them all across this country this week, Father. I pray the hand of God, the hand of Almighty God, will rest upon those men and women. I pray protection would come to them. I pray for those, particularly I pray that officer and his family, family of that officer down in Houston, Texas, Father, they, I can't imagine the grief they're experiencing today. Wife, children, parents, probably brothers and sisters, you can't imagine the agony, the pain, the hurt. You can't imagine the anger that they're feeling feeling today. And I pray, Father, I pray your hand would just rest in a marvelous way upon the Lord. Then, Lord, I pray for that group of people who just simply weren't seemingly satisfied with relationships, and so they sought some other relationship, and, Lord, some of them are in our churches today. There's a lot of heartache in some of our churches today as a result of what went on this past week. I pray the Holy Spirit will God protect me as a minister of the gospel of Jesus. I pray the angel that's been assigned to me garrison about me this way, such a marvelous way to take my mind, protect my body, protect my spirit. God, send us out of here with a new zeal, a new love, a new compassion to bring people to know Jesus in His name.
Let's sing our closing song, the song we started with this morning, Change My Heart, O God. Change my heart.